All right, everyone, here's a riddle for you. How can a game simultaneously be obscure and nigh forgotten, and at the same time be a first-party Nintendo title? Give up? I'll tell you how. You'll be Custom Robo. Or, Star Tropics, I guess that works too. I mean, stupid ice climbers got into Smash Bros. Melee, but... Greetings, everyone. This is the Robo Snek. Here to talk about the sorely underloved Nintendo property that hasn't seen an installment since the original DS. Custom Robo is a series of games that originated back on the N64 starting in 1999, but the first three titles never left Japan. It wasn't until the fourth installment on the Nintendo GameCube in 2004 that we finally got what we came to know as Custom Robo, known in Japan with the subtitle of Battle Revolution. The game starred 12-inch-tall robots that get to, here's the shocker, customize, coupled against a larger-than-life robo-centric story about friendship, super weapons, and the fact that the Earth is round. I'm joking less than you might think, so let's dig in. The story begins with our typical unassuming protagonist having a vivid dream about his missing and presumed late father and a very specific and cryptic set of instructions left by him. Taking this to heart, the protagonist goes to Steel Hearts, a mercenary outfit in order to start life as a commander, only to learn that he is, in fact, an idiot and has no idea how robos even work, and he doesn't even own one for himself. In order to convince him that he's about to make a huge mistake in career choice, the hero goes along with Harry, who acts as the game's walking tutorial, in order to fend off a criminal gang from attacking the local robo R&D lab. Whereupon the hero boneheadedly, bravely, activates the Ray 01, a new model right off development, and fends off the criminals by effectively stealing first what they plan to steal for themselves. Well, it works in the end, I guess, so he's encouraged to keep it and join Steel Hearts in earnest. Things get more complex, however, as we venture ever deeper into this world of tiny robot battles and eventually get caught up in a grand conspiracy that was decades in the making. Graphically, the game looks fantastic. The overworld, where we play our fleshy human self, is bright and colorful, and every character is given a distinct color and motif. Like Harry has a strong green and yellow color scheme, and Marcia has blue and blacks, and the protagonist is a shonen protagonist. The world is presented in vivid detail. Whether on the overworld map or in a zone, things you can and can't interact with are made clear. And once we dive into our robos, we get a stark neon-on-black setting with sharp edges and super awesome-looking robots armed to the teeth with the gear, pods, and guns. The robos themselves are a thing of beauty, being technophile that I am, to say nothing of the special effects that each weapon has. And that character motif thing transfers over to their robos, as not only does each robo have its own default color palette, but it also possesses a red, blue, green, and yellow variant, which help tremendously in the game's frenetic multiplayer mode if more than one player picks that particular robo. And even beyond that, Harry's robo, the Glory, maintains his green theme, and Marcia's robo, Milky Way, has a similar blue theme to the Operator. I gotta say, we here in the West only ever got two of these games, this one and Arena on the Nintendo DS, as I mentioned, but this is up and away my favorite in terms of art direction for the franchise. It really embraces the sci-fi aspects, and I love it. And the game sounds great, too. The music is catchy, kind of in a techno genre for the most part, with aspects of electronica, I think, and it really helps set the mood. The overworld map song is kind of a sleepy melody, but when battle kicks in, you hear that guitar going full speed with a rock motif, you know that you're in for a wild ride. The game also does that sort of sound-to-speech thing where characters aren't voiced but rather make a particular sound when their text is crawling across the field. I really don't know what you call that. But it works, and it helps reflect each character's unique attitude and the kind of message they're trying to convey. The sound effects are bombastic, and they're all over the place, particularly sounds tied to the many, many armaments your robo can wield. It's really just an aesthetically pleasing game overall. And now my favorite part, the gameplay. Custom Robo heavily hinges upon the robos, no lid duh, am I right? And how you, well, you customize them. Robos are broken down to 5 pieces, and you can change any at any time that you're not presently in a fight. Body, which will dictate the robo's base stats and dash attack, their gun, which is their primary weapon, bomb being a secondary weapon, and pod, the tertiary weapon, and legs, which augment how you move and jump. each of these have their own stats, like raw damage output, reload times, firing rate, and so on. And as you progress through the story, you'll be awarded various parts to expand your customization options, and this is explained in-game as the hero growing more experienced as a commander. And you'll pretty much welcome to try any combination you think will work for your playstyle. You'll constantly be adapting to different opponents and various styles of play, so try to find what works best for you. Once in a battle, every encounter will start semi-randomly with the Robo's cubes, that being the form they take when they're inactive, being launched from cannons to start. A number will gradually tick downwards towards zero, and if the cube is firmly on the ground when that time comes, your Robo launches like Athena from the head of Zeus, raring to go. The strategy to any successful launch is, well, not landing in obvious damage zones like magma for one, and tapping the face buttons to speed up the counter only when it's advantageous. If your cube is in the cannon or still hasn't fully stopped, going past 1 will just reset the counter to 9. But once the robos are in the thick of it, the face and shoulder buttons control your gear and move your robo. But I won't bore you by becoming a talking instruction booklet or anything, but suffice it to say, the robo battles will heat up fast. And while mini battles are handled one-on-one, you'll also have to deal with 2v2s, 1-on-3 dogpiles, and even the occasional super boss fight, where the game lets you tackle them 3-on-1, and it will still be a challenge. This is partly due to the game's special flavor of balance between what are called legal and illegal robo parts. Illegal robo parts typically have huge advantages over their legal counterparts, or they have quirks that make them really powerful that, in story at least, they can actively injure a commander via psychosympathetic shock. Yeah, try saying that 10 times fast. This isn't even getting into the aforementioned multiplayer versus mode, which will get absolutely crazy, as every part you've unlocked in the story mode will be available there too. Oh yeah, that reminds me. Here's a small personal story. Once, during a high school era sleepover, yes, I'm dating myself again, but bear with me, Yutaku, Kog, and I decided to have a three-way free-for-all, during which we all decided to utilize the illegal worm gun, which has insanely high stats all across the board. So imagine three robos scrambling across the field, massive streams of lethal purple dragons screaming across it, as the three of us are frantically crying out, "Whose shots are those?" After the ashes settled, we decided to ban the worm gun, because not only is it severely OP, but we began losing track of whose bullets were whose, and it made the entire game incomprehensible. Now we stick to using the dragon gun, which is similar but less homing and only one gigantic dragon head to dodge, instead of 5 or 6. Outside of battle, you have free range to explore and challenge people to battles and to engage in banter. And this is a place where the game will really shine. You get multiple choice options at almost every moment you're spoken to, and you can make the protagonist out to be a complete moron if you're inclined. The game's writing is incredibly funny and deeply charming, with everyone having their own distinct personality and sense of style. While it takes itself seriously enough that the villains will come off as legitimate, even as silly as some robo battles can look to bystanders, which even the game itself acknowledges to some extent, the overall tone tends to lean on the comedic side of action comedy, and it does the game a world of good. This also helps alleviate tension that the game is pretty forgiving, wherein if you lose a battle, you usually get a small bit of banter and an immediate chance to jump in and try again, which is to the game's credit, as some of the later game content can get quite challenging. So, if I love it so much, how could this game have been improved? Well, for starters, a little more control over when you unlock some of the weapons would have been nice, even if the game is generous in handing them out to you. The game has no currency system, so you really earn what you unlock rather directly. Next, I think the way the sequel, Arena, handled the cubes at the start of battles is just a little bit easier and more difficult for the RNG to screw over what would otherwise have been a competent start to a match, due to the timer being randomized every time you launch. Other than that, I just want more custom robo, plain and simple. And that's kind of a problem, though. This is the time where I have to talk about the bad news. To start, the first three games never left Japan. This game was only released in Japan and America. It wasn't until Arena in 2006 and 2007 that the game was released in PAL regions, and it's all been dead air ever since. Despite being 5 games long and fairly popular in their days, custom robos pretty much never discussed anymore, and the only attention they get nowadays is as an assist trophy in Super Smash Bros. And they all deserved so much more. This one in particular is my favorite. I hope against hope Nintendo considers an HD re-release or even just a virtual console-ish arrangement for it. I'd really like for Custom Robo 6 to happen, but to be frank, it's been 14 years now. But you never know, stranger things have happened. So, fellow commanders, keep your hopes high and try to track down a copy of these games for yourselves. They are absolutely worth it to this day. I guarantee if anything I've said today sounds good to you, you will love every moment of it, maybe as much as I do. But for now, the sign-off. This has been the Commander Snek. If you liked today's video, definitely tap that like button to let me know. And if you want more like this every week, hit those subscribe and bell icons so you'll never miss a beat. Leave a comment down below telling me your favorite Robo. I admit I really love Ray01's design in particular. And you can follow me on the Twitters for hints at future updates or even the subscribe star to fund my Robo battles as they come. Thanks for joining me here today, and I hope you'll continue to do so for more obscure games and indie excellence. And I'll see you there. Hey everyone, this is the Hipster Snek. I just wanted to bring to everyone's attention that I'm holding a bit of a contest. You see, the channel's rapidly approaching 100 subscribers, which is a milestone I never dreamed I would hit within the first year of the channel's activity. That in mind, I am opening a poll, both on my YouTube comment section under the page itself, and on the Twitter, at HipsterSnek, where you can vote for a game you want me to review for the 100 subscriber special. The only limitation is it has to be something that I have a means of playing, and it can't be something that gets me banned off YouTube for having played it. That said, go wild. Whatever game you want me to cover for the 100 sub special, I will do when that time comes. So be sure to leave your vote either in the comment section on my YouTube channel or on the pinned tweet at HipsterSnek. When the subtotal crests 100, that will be the time that that video is the next to go live. That'll give you something to look forward to, and I will see you there.